So when I came to Croydon Church as an intern and was appointed to plant a new church in Wellington, I realized that there is a problem within Seventh-day Adventist Church to connect with the community. So the first one of the major things when people thought about planting a new church was to bring some members of the mother church. And I realized also as a pastor who was attending Area 6B meetings that there is some sort of fighting for the church members between churches. So idea of planting the church was more based on take the members from other churches than to gain the non-church people. So I realized very soon that not only that is the problem, but also the problem is that people from the church, they don't know how to connect with the community. So their all contacts and their all relationships are based within the church. So and there was a lack of communication with the community. So no one had any friends outside of the church circles. So that was really something that surprised me. When I came to Wellington and I discovered three church members in Wellington, and when I started to talk to them, you know, they couldn't even didn't have connections with their neighbors. So I realized soon that something needs to be done, you know, and help those people, you know, to start to reconnect with the people from the community. In that direction, I started to pray really heavily every morning during my morning walks and jogging and meditations, and I started to pray really to God to give me some, you know, inspiration, you know, with something that I can give to those church members, that we can start and we can, you know, break that, you know, barrier between the church and between the local community. So in one of those walks, that inspiration came, Community Chaplaincy Services. So that was it, you know. I was so excited that I ran home like a wind to put everything on the paper, so before I forget. So I came home and put everything on the paper, and I came to those three individuals from Wellington, and I told them we are going out and we are going to knock on the doors of the community. So three Caribbean ladies were totally surprised, and when I told them that we're going to knock on the door of the community, they said to me, better kill us right now than expose us to the doors of this community, because those are wealthy, white professionals and people, and they're going just to slam the doors on our faces. So, but with the first experience, when we went out and we regularly started to go out, they completely changed their perception of that community. So the experience of engaging people in conversation and the response of the local people from local community was really great. So their fear and the whole, you know, barrier between them and that community was broken. So in such a way that even when I wasn't in the country, some of them called me to tell me their experiences when they went out. So they couldn't wait even for me to come back to tell me what was the actual experience. The chaplain is in a hospital, chaplain is in a jail, chaplain is in any educational institution. So the community is the biggest educational institution, you know. You can learn more in the community than anywhere else. So especially the relationship with God and experience with God. That I said so many times, and I'll tell again, that people that are sitting in a church never experience Jesus if they don't stop out of those churches. So before we go, we start and pray to the owner of that community where to go, what is the part of the town that God really wants us to go and have an impact on that part of the town. And the same way we start to pray about the individual, that we can go in pairs. So who is the individual that has a similar lifestyle, obligations, life responsibilities, so that we can come together and go out. So there is no particular day or time when we go out every time, whenever we're free to go. Once we have those individuals together, and when God inspires us with a certain area of the town where to go and how to go, Then we go in the twos, we divide the territories, streets between twos, and we start to go. So we knock on the door, we present ourselves as a members of local community, of local Seventh-day Adventist group, and we promoting community chaplaincy services. So everyone knows what chaplain does, so we don't have a hidden agenda. So everyone, majority people in England, knows very well what is the role of the chaplain, especially those ones they've been experienced with the hospitals, with the jails, with the, any educational institution. They know very well what chaplain does. So we don't need to explain that we pray, that we share word of God, and that we support immediate needs of the people. And the most interesting part of community chaplaincy services is the least confrontational way to go into the community. So you have a believers, you have a non-believers. Whatever the belief of those individuals, you don't offend them because you're going there as a chaplain. So they know that you pray, they know that you share word of God, and they know that you have a care and support for that community. So you don't pushing your doctrines. You're not there to teach them Seventh-day Adventist doctrines. You're there to introduce God and support them, or to together with them pray to the same God and have an impact or on the life of people around, or that individual life, or particular family, or whoever. So the prayer is not strange for Catholics, not strange for Muslims, not strange for Buddhists. Just last Thursday, I met a young guy in a shepherd's bush. He is nothing to do with the Christianity, but he said, "I pray." I said, "How do you pray?" He said, "I pray regularly, you know, and I believe in prayer. Can I join in prayer?" "Of course you can." So, you know, he's a Buddhist. I'm a Christian, Seventh-day Adventist, but, you know, we have a common ground, the prayer, so we can talk about the prayer, you know. So I'm going to visit him next Thursday, so the prayer opened the door for that visitation. So from there, we're going to develop our relationship. So the most important thing, going outside, developing that relationship. So that's the one of the extreme things. In the same way, you know, when you talk about the extreme things, is, you know, about other religion. So we have extreme experience with the Muslims, for example. In Shepherd's Bush, two ladies, we just separated in our ways. Two of them went one way, I went the other way. So, and after maybe a few minutes, I received the call, "Come as soon as possible to such and such address and number." So I said, "What happened?" I said, "Don't ask anything, just come straight." So I went there and knocked on the door. And then Muslim lady completely covered, opened the door, invited me in, and we said in, three, those two members from Shepherd's Bush already there, and she, and that Muslim lady. So we started to talk, and Muslim lady started to cry. So I asked her, "Why are you crying?" And she said, "Can you tell me that God can forgive my sin?" So I invited her to pray with us, so we went on our knees and we prayed together. So after that, she even started to cry even more, you know. But she said, "Now I'm not crying for the sadness and grief, I'm crying with the joy and the gladness that I opened the door to you today, and that you came here, and that I'm praying with you, and I'm convicted that God can forgive my sin." So that lady is keeping contact with us. She's not in the church, but those guys, we are visiting her, and they're developing that relationship. When God is going to move that lady, remove that covering Muslim robes and all these tradition and ways of her worship, I don't know. I don't know if it's going to happen at all, but the most important thing that I have that beautiful experience, and that I can see that God using us to impact the people's life, and that God can introduce Himself through us to the people, even those extreme people like that Muslim lady. So I met her on the street recently, and she even shook my hand in the middle of the street in front of the whole public place, and she is a Muslim lady, core Muslim, covered completely, you know. So when she extended her hand, I didn't know what's happening, but when she started to talk, I recognized the voice, so I realized that was the lady that we were praying for her. A yesterday met a lady that is completely non-believer, don't believe in anything, but last week she was discovered, diagnosed with breast cancer, so we prayed together yesterday, and she accepted us to come back next week, so to continually pray for her to go through that, you know, unpleasant, you know, discovery that she is diagnosed with breast cancer. So, there is so many different ways to connect with the people. So, and the most important thing is to go with that connection with the people, not to force your agenda. So go with the people. So whatever is their immediate need, coming across young couple, British young couple, 20s, 20, 22, 3 years old, when we knocked on the door, the girl opened the door and she was in a black, and when we presented ourselves and when we asked her about the prayer, she said she doesn't need a prayer, everything is fine. And then a young guy came behind her from the door and said, why don't we pray for such and such a name? So the girl said, good, now I have to tell them all the story. So she told us the story. That was the child that she delivered a dead child a year ago, there was an incident in the hospital, so she delivered that child. So after that experience, they tried, you know, to have another child. She couldn't get pregnant at all. So when we came, she told us that they're struggling now with the pregnancy. So the most important thing when you knock on the doors is to listen to people. So the easiest way to engage people in conversation is just to simply ask a question, you know. How are you today? And from how are you today, they'll tell you absolutely everything. So there are some people that probably never spend a whole week in the house not talking to anyone, or maybe more than a week. They're busy with their lives, or maybe they're elderly, no one having a time for them. But from very simple, the easiest way to engage is just to ask simple questions. So asking a simple questions, people telling the whole life. Even when they're saying they don't have a time, they stay with you on the door for an hour and tells you they how much they don't have a time. But they standing over there and telling you 1 hour they don't have a time for those things. So in the same way that young girl and that young couple told us about the problem of pregnancy, so it's important to listen what are they talking. So we said, let us pray for that pregnancy. So we pray for that pregnancy, and after 3 months of revisitation and prayer for the pregnancy, the girl became pregnant. So the girl was pregnant, and you know, that was the revelation of God in the and the power of prayer and the relevance of God, the relevance of prayer in the life of those young people. So from there, it wasn't very, you know, difficult to persuade them to open the Bible and start to have a Bible study. So they now join the young people in and they have a Bible studies, and they're not coming to church yet, but you know, I wish they come, but you know, as I said at the beginning, that's not my business, that's God's business. When God is going to inspire them, when God is going to touch the hearts of those people to join the church, or you know, ask that question to join and come to church, I cannot tell, and I'm not disappointed. I'm just so glad that I had the opportunity to introduce God into the life of those people. So they experience God and prayer firsthand. So now I don't need to tell them much about the doctrine, because they have their convictions. So their little, no faith was born in that instance when they experienced that prayer. So by going there week after week, they know more about you. You know more about them. In meantime, prayer works. So the lady complained when her daughter couldn't pass driving test for 7-8 times. So we pray for this test, came back next week. The first thing the lady, when she opened the door with the excitement and joy and everything, said, do you know what's happened? What's happened? The daughter passed the test. So immediate experience of the prayer. So, coming week after week is important, because you know, there are some people, and there is, and also life is not static. Life is something that is changing all the time. So you'll be inspired by God where to knock, even on the doors that you've been rejected. God will inspire you to go back to that door. And as experience with one lady, a very extreme experience, two members of Wellington community, they knock on the door of that lady. She slammed the door first time. They went the second time. She did the same thing. Third time, when knock on the same door, lady opened the door crying. What's happened? She showed them the letter from social services that they discovered that she is an alcohol addict and that she cannot care for the 2 years old son. She neglected the son completely and she just drank whole day and slept on the floor and doing nothing. And so they send a letter that they're going to take the child and they're going to put her in some rehab program so that she can recover, and then they can consider maybe, you know, join them together sometimes in the future. So she was desperate when she received that letter, and in the same time she said, I was so stupid. So they ask you, why are you so stupid? She said, I rejected you already 2 times and I'm so stupid, and you knocking on my door and you want to help me and you want to pray for me, and look at me now, I'm losing my child, so I cannot live without my child, I'm going to leave this country. So they brought her for prayer meeting. The whole group prayed for the social services to reverse their decision. Sabbath morning, we had a regular worship, and after Sabbath school, we just preparing, you know, to the main worship. The lady, like wind, came through the door of our little hall with a letter in her hand and shouting from the door, Pastor, I would like to be baptized. The letter, she received the letter that morning. Sabbath morning from social services, they reverse their decision. So they're not going to take the child from her, but they're going to support them and help them. So a child was put in a special school, child starting to speak now, and with the support of church members and everything, she gave up alcohol without any rehab program, without anything, and now she is preparing herself for baptism. I believe that every church in South England Conference, not only South England Conference, but in British Union, should be a community chaplaincy center of that community. So that people know in that community that there is an institution in that community where they can come, where they can call, when they can be visited, they can be supported, they can be prayed for all sorts of reasons. So the most important thing of that is that you don't go once in that community. So once you go into community as a tool for the first time, as soon as you establish 3 solid contacts, you stop knocking on the doors, but you're coming week after week and you are present in the community. So the community, that little few streets around, people very quickly recognize that you're coming week after week. So your face become familiar, and they know exactly what you do here, why you coming. So you don't need to do much, you know. As soon as the one member of that community find out who you are, so the whole community, the network of the community, especially those people on the street, is a very strong network. They network with them, you know, it's strong, and very quickly that the community is informed immediately. There is a couple of people that are coming every week here. They pray, they share word of God, and they support. They can feed you, they can help you with employment, they can help you with the education, they can help you with translation of your immigration documents, they can do all, they can provide maybe, you know, a support to gain some accommodation, you know, to feed you, help you through the winter time. And I mean, there is a 1,000,001 program in our churches that we do and that we offer, but the most important thing that we make those programs accessible to those people. And that was the problem, there is no accessibility between, you know, church programs and the community, because church was just locked, isolated, and there was a barrier. Now we have opportunity to break that barrier, and through that relationship with the community, offer everything that we can offer and help that community. So that's the experience of the people. In that context, you know, once you get the 3 contacts, what are the 3 solid contacts? 3 solid contacts when the people ask you to come back next week. That's the solid contact. So far, every time I go out, there are people that are complaining that's impossible. Every time so far, I've been going out for 3-4 years already, so there wasn't any particular time that I wasn't able to make a 3 solid contact. It means that people ask me, can you come back next week and to pray for me again? So once those 3 individual contacts are developed, then you introduce those contacts to each other, and then you have a little group of, you know, like small group, prayer group. So if two people from every church has a three non-Adventist people every week for a prayer, that is the impact that it's amazing impact. But what I'm saying, I already said that every time I go, I spend maximum hour and a half before I get those three solid contacts that I can, they have a request to come back. So when that happened, when you introduce those three people to each other, and when you join them, there's a five people in a prayer group, but it's usually more than five, because those three are much harder. They're going to promote that community chaplaincy services harder than anyone else, because they're experiencing God in their life, and they experience health and support. So they're spreading that support to the relatives, to the friends, to the neighbors, so that you might end up, you know, instead of having a three non-Adventists, you might have five, seven or more than that. So depends what's happening in that particular street. So you start your Bible studies, friendly Bible studies, readings, so people as not only prayer, but also the Word of God as a tremendous impact on people's life when they start to read the Bible, when they discover, you know, the principles of God's principles and God's character and everything else. People, you know, is amazed with all these things, and this is something that you cannot explain how much impact on their people's life. So even those that are religious, like I had a young Catholic guy who we were reading Birth of Jesus. So when we read that the angel approached the Joseph, he was completely perplexed and disturbed, and he jumped and he started to check the Bible and everything. And he said, I being a Catholic, I know only the God and angel approached the Mary. I don't know anything about the Joseph. So there is so many, you know, experiences of people just simply reading a Bible. So when you start to read the Bible, we, in this context, we don't force our beliefs and doctrines. We just go through the experiential reading. So people tell their experience, but at the end they'll ask you, what do you think about that? So when they ask you, what do you think, then you have opportunity to tell your opinion and your beliefs and everything else. So the real experience with God begins when you step out and when you start to walk in that community, and when you start to be led by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, when the Spirit starts to speak through you, and when you impact the life of the people in that community, when God works, when God uses you. So the personal experience, personal conviction is mine. When every time when I go, God witnessed to me how He works and how God wants me to, you know, God, how God revealed to me, you know, Himself and myself in many different ways. So the first benefit is for me personally when I go out, and then through that personal experience, I see how God works with other people.